Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents On to the Asteroid by Travis S. Taylor and Les Johnson. Narrated by Derek Shoales. Prologue. Somewhere along Lake Baikal was a glorious time for the boy and his family. The brutal winter was over, and the longer days of summer were upon them. The lake was crystal clear and almost completely still, reflecting the light of the sun-like gems set in an expensive ring that might belong to a czarina. The morning was cool, about 50 degrees, and the boy was outside doing his chores. His father was tending the cattle, and his mother was busy weeding the garden they kept behind the modest house in which he and his three siblings lived with their parents. Not much happened during the all-too-short summers in Siberia. The snow and ice melted, and the darkness that seemed to define their lives for most of the year took a vacation. The skies tended to be clear and blue during the day, and filled with the mysterious stars at night. The boy's father would often tell his children stories about his ancestors, whom he claimed were nobles in exile, as they sat around their cooking fire in the long twilight so typical of northern latitudes. None in the family had received a formal education, and they didn't expect that any of them would ever do so. They were farmers, and farmers they would remain. The boy had a few friends, and they planned to get together later in the day, after their chores were behind them, to go fishing and perhaps swimming in the lake. As cold as it was far warmer and tempting now than at any other time of the year. He looked forward to these outings with his friends. They were a welcome respite from his work and the unpleasant habits of his older sister. Since she turned 14, she had become almost unbearable to be around. All she seemed to think and talk about were boys. The boy, himself only 10, promised himself that when he turned 14, he wouldn't spend all his time thinking and talking about girls. Never. He was clearing debris from the previous week's storm from the outer part of the field, near the lake, when the column of blinding blue light flashed across the sky to the north. It was brighter than the sun, and its light reflected from the surface of the lake was blinding. There was no sound, and that, more than the light, disturbed the boy. He dropped the branches he'd gathered and began running toward the house. He could see his sister just outside the house staring dumbfounded into the sky. His father was emerging from the barn and appeared to be looking for the source of the light that had undoubtedly brightened its interior. He had just reached his sister, the one about whom he had just been complaining, when the shockwave struck them. Time passed in what seemed like slow motion to the boy. He saw the debris at the front of the blast wave only moments before it reached him, yet it seemed like several minutes. Dirt, debris, and even water were being thrown into the air as what seemed like a wall of air reached them standing just beside their house. He had to cover his eyes to protect them from the dust and dirt in the air. He then heard the sound of the house being battered by the sudden gust of strong wind and saw parts of the roof flying off, along with the window shutters and much of the siding that covered the right side of the house. The sound was deafening as the light had been blinding. He was terrified. Simultaneously, with the arrival of the shockwave, the ground trembled like in an earthquake. What the wind had not blown over, the shaking earth did its best to tumble. The cookstand collapsed onto the fire that had been lit this morning to cook breakfast, and much of the fence the boy's father was building shook out of the post holes and onto the ground. After it, whatever it was, had passed, the boy and his family were all alive and mostly uninjured. The damage to their property was significant but repairable, and aside from there being some exciting tales exchanged with their neighbors, who had similar experiences, the most lasting effects of the mysterious light and ensuing storm were the stories. Only a few hundred miles away, it was a completely different story, resulting from what scientists would later estimate was the equivalent of a 10-megaton nuclear bomb, or one about 1,000 times more powerful than the atomic bomb dropped on Hiroshima, but without the nuclear radiation. A meteor or a comet had crossed paths with the Earth, entered the atmosphere, and exploded just before impact at an altitude of about 5 miles. The affected area beneath the blast was over 800 square miles, and, fortunately, it was mostly uninhabited. The boy and his family were in one of the closest villages to the impact zone, and because they weren't within it, they survived. 80 million trees and the animals living among them weren't so lucky. The damage within the zone where the object exploded was nearly complete. The year was 1908. And it was just another day in the life of the solar system. Chapter 1. Gessling estimated that he had less than 2 minutes to live. The status board in front of him was lit up like a Christmas tree, one decorated with all red lights, and if the klaxon didn't stop sounding soon, he thought he might die before the lander impacted the surface of the moon in what company parlance would deem a hard landing. To Gessling, the best he could hope for now was just a hard landing. Unless he did something soon, he was going to crash. Time did seem to slow down, though his life wasn't passing before his eyes. He wasn't thinking of his last night with his wife Carolyn, or of his parents and childhood. He was completely focused on saving his own skin and the multi-hundred-million-dollar investment that was the lander he was piloting to the surface of the moon. There wasn't much time. Just a few minutes before, the situation board was all green, and he had initiated the main engine burn that would take him and the lander from lunar orbit to a powered descent and landing on the moon. This test flight was part of Space Excursion's latest commercial space venture, and one that would set the stage for landing tourists at the world's first hotel on the surface of the moon within a year. He and his co-pilot, Bill Stetson, had rehearsed the mission for months, and they thought they'd run through a simulation for just about everything that could possibly go wrong. Everything but whatever the hell had just caused the main engine to shut down after beginning the deorbit maneuver. Thanks to the laws derived by Mr. Newton, he and the lander were going to land on the moon. The only question left at this point was just how hard the landing would be. Gessling touched the screen in front of him and called up the latest engineering information about the ship's systems, frantically trying to isolate the problem and figure out how to recover. The engine had shut down suddenly, and that meant that the computer had detected an anomaly that would have resulted in an explosion if it hadn't been shut down. The system was designed to prevent the worst case. In this situation, it may have avoided the worst case, but the second worst case replacing it was not much better.
Paul, listen up. I'm seeing the same data as you, and I think I found the problem.
That was the voice Bill Stetson, his co-pilot for the mission, who was on the module that remained in lunar orbit after Gessling and the lander had separated from it. Stetson was not just Gessling's colleague. They were also friends. Bill had joined Space Excursions after retiring from NASA and was one of the few people in the world who had already walked on the moon, albeit in a rescue mission just a few years ago. That had also been one that nearly ended in disaster.
I'm all yours, Bill. What have you got? Be quick, I'm in a bad way down here.
You need to restart the main engine and it should be okay. The sensors in the LED showed that a gas bubble was in the fuel line and they shut the engine down to prevent an explosion. For some reason, the backup sensor, which doesn't show any vapor, didn't kick in and keep you going. We need to figure out why, but that doesn't matter now. You need to cycle the engine and restart.
Stetson sounded cool and authoritative as he spoke. Gessling made a quick mental note that attributed his calm demeanor to his being an old-school NASA astronaut who had faced crises like this before. Gessling felt anything but calm.
Cycling the engine now. And you're sure there's no vapor in the line?
I give it a 50-50 chance. Seems to be a better chance than what you've got without the engine on and working.
I'll take it,
said Gessling as he completed the restart sequence on the liquid methane-powered engine that would now either explode and end his life in literal blaze of glory or provide him with a mere hard landing on the lunar surface. He held his breath as the restart sequence completed and the red engine status light turned from red to yellow, and he felt the harsh bump accompanying the engine start. He didn't die, and he was relieved.
Hot damn! Bill, you saved my skin.
All in a day's work, my friend. Now just make sure nothing else goes wrong in the next few minutes. You've got a ship to land.
Roger that, said Gessling.
He looked briefly around the Spartan command center of the lander, watching red light after red light wink from red to yellow to green. All except for the one that was monitoring his descent rate. He was still dropping much too fast. The engine hadn't yet had time to slow him to the speed at which he should be descending from this altitude. There was nothing he could do except wait for the burn to remove as much speed as possible before they touched the surface. In theory, when the landing gear touched the surface, the relative velocity of the lander should be zero. In theory. Gessling looked out the window at the starkly gray lunar landscape as he monitored his descent rate out of the corner of his eye on the screen in front of him. He could clearly see, with acuity almost indescribable, the contrast between the lunar craters and surface features against the dark blackness of space. The sunlight reflecting from the lunar regolith was blinding, especially as the dust currently being kicked up from his ship's engine crossed his line of sight, obscuring the features he was previously admiring. The lunar dust danced with random Brownian motion and vortices and swirls, creating a chaotic ballet of flickering sunlight. A quick glance at the laser altimeter told him how high above the surface he was, and from that, how fast he was dropping. It wasn't a perfect descent, but at least the sensor showed that the descent rate of speed and the altitude were close to converging on zero, which would be a good thing as long as that convergence happened above the surface and not below. In other words, he hoped it happened before he smacked into the moon. But the numbers hadn't converged yet, and that meant that he and the ship would touch the moon, altitude zero, with a speed greater than zero. Hopefully not too much greater than zero. On Earth, and in most casual conversation, this would be called a crash. On Earth, a crash you could walk away from and a bad landing you could still fly away from. A bad crash required an ambulance. Gessling was now hoping for a bad landing, but he'd settle for a crash provided it wasn't a bad one. There weren't any ambulances out there at 400,000 kilometers from Earth, at least none that could be there anytime soon. The lander reached zero altitude while the speed indicator showed he was moving at 5 kilometers per hour. He felt the not very gentle whoomp of the gear taking most of the initial impact before the entire lander jolted, rocked, and then settled into a full stop. Most automobiles had better than a 5-kilometer impact bumper. He wasn't driving a car.
"I'm still alive," thought Gessling as he looked around the cabin and made sure it wasn't about to explode or have some piece of rock plunge through its skin.
The ship stopped rocking and remained fully upright. The status board showed that all systems were working, and all of the red lights that had previously indicated his imminent death and doom were now green. It was then that he realized he was holding his breath and let out an explosive exhalation.
"Paul, are you okay down there?"
asked Stetson from high above, probably now flying over the lunar far side with his voice being relayed by one of the small CubeSat communication satellites now orbiting and providing global communications and positioning information to anyone and everyone on the moon. In other words, the CubeSats were relaying the message to Paul since he was the only one there at the moment.
"Bill, I'm not only okay, I'm pumped. She landed hard, but there is no indication of damage. I'm walking through the shutdown sequence now."
"I'm glad to hear it. I know Mr. Childers and a certain Carolyn O'Connor Gessling are also glad for that. I'm not sure, but I think they were both chewing nails back in Nevada as they watched your status board light up."
"I'll get on the private channel with them as soon as I make sure the ship is secure. What a way to end your career, eh? Were you expecting deja vu up there?"
"Hey, don't remind me. I may be retiring after this flight, but that doesn't mean I'm out to pasture yet. I was already running through options to get a rescue ship down there to you while you were restarting that engine. I did it once, and I could do it again. But if it's all the same with you, I'd rather not."
"Not is fine by me," said Gessling as he went through the post-landing checklist on his helmet's heads-up display.
He couldn't help but muse at the fact that just 5 years ago, Bill Stetson had been the one piloting a NASA ship to the moon's surface. He'd been on a mission to find and bring home the survivors of a wrecked Chinese lunar lander that Gessling had found on the world's first commercial lunar flyby. He'd brought them all home safely, despite what seemed to be an endless stream of mishaps, and now he was part of Gary Childers' private space company that would soon be bringing tourists for a week's stay at the company's lunar hotel. Thinking of the hotel prompted Gessling to take his first real look out the window since the dust kicked up from his rocket engine had settled. He scanned the horizon, looking for it, and found it almost immediately. Clearly not natural, and standing out rather starkly against the deep gray of the lunar surface, was the out-of-this-world, Space Excursions' lunar habitat and hotel, waiting on its first paying customers. From a distance, Gessling was able to confirm what the out-of-this-world's onboard cameras and those from orbit showed, that the hotel was in one piece and undamaged. Gessling would soon find out for himself. After securing the ship, he was going to exit the airlock and take his first stroll across the lunar surface to check it out.
"Thank God he didn't put flashing neon lights on it," Gessling thought as he continued working his way through the checklist.
About 45 minutes later, Gessling finished powering down the lander and adjusting his spacesuit for his short stroll to the out-of-this-world. He was nervous without a doubt. Between him and the hotel was just about the deadliest environment humanity had ever decided to explore. An airless world bathed in unfiltered sunlight, which would cause his ambient temperature to increase above 200 degrees Celsius if it weren't for the suit's built-in air conditioner. Accompanying the abundant sunlight was a steady stream of ionized particle radiation, the solar wind, and the risk of a sudden solar storm that could dose him with enough radiation to kill him outright.
A walk in the park,
he thought as he opened the door from the lander to the airless lunar surface. Gessling eased his way down the ladder from the lander to the surface and soon felt the reassuring solidness of the ground beneath him. It wasn't the ground he was used to, and that made his heart rate increase. He could hear the blood pumping in his ears and his rapid, deep breaths as he took his first steps on another world. Unlike the explorers who had come before, the Apollo astronauts, the returning Americans that included Bill Stetson, the Russians, and now the Chinese, he didn't make any pithy comments meant for public consumption. Instead, he chose to remain quiet and in his own thoughts during those first few moments.
Paul, if you don't say something, I'm going to get in a rocket and come up there to beat some sense into you.
The voice on the speaker was that of his wife, and Space Excursion's very own media liaison, Carolyn O'Connor Gessling. When they'd met about 7 years ago, Gessling had no idea she would become his wife. At this moment, he wasn't sure if she was speaking as his mate or as the chief publicity officer for Space Excursions.
Yeah, right. I guess I should,
Gessling said, thinking of the words he'd rehearsed with Carolyn and Mr. Childers before he'd departed Earth just 3 days ago.
This is Paul Gessling of Space Excursions, taking the first steps by a non-government employee on the surface of another world. Today is a new beginning for humanity, a beginning that will fulfill the promises made to a previous generation by opening up the space frontier to all of us. And I dare say, it is about time.
Gessling looked down at the footprints he was making in the dirt so that his headset camera feed would clearly image them for all back home to see. He continued,
These footprints aren't being made by some elite, out-of-reach, and too-perfect astronaut. They're mine, and you can add yours to them soon by signing up for Space Excursion's ultimate getaway, a week-long stay on the moon. I may be the first to land here and walk this path to the hotel ahead of me, but I won't be the last. Join Space Excursion as we make space an affordable excursion for all. It may be only one small step for a man, but it most certainly is a giant leap that every member of mankind can take.
Perfect, said Carolyn. Now you can forget about all the PR stuff and get yourself safely into the out of this world. I'll process the footage and get it out on the net before you can get settled in for your rest break.
Carolyn, I miss you.
I miss you too, but we've both got work to do, she said.
After a brief pause, she added,
And Paul, be careful.
Right, careful. Always.
Paul smiled, though nobody could see it. He'd switched the interior helmet camera view off. He looked around at the lunarscape spread out around him. The landing vehicle and ascent system was like something out of the old science fiction movies he'd watched as a kid. Only now, he was the would-be hero on a daring space adventure.
Onward and upward it is.
Gessling said to himself, wiping the smile from his face. He was already looking forward to being home and in his wife's embrace. But first, he had a moon to cross, or at least several hundred meters of moon to cross.
Pinch me now, he thought.
The walk on the moon felt just like he'd thought it would. It was almost exactly like the bungee cord rigging system they had developed to simulate walking on the moon back at Space Excursions on Earth. The training system would serve future lunar tourists well. There was a slight difference, though. On Earth, even though the bungees made his steps and jumps much longer, the full feel of one Earth gravity was still ever-present. On the moon, however, he felt light as air. Old aches and pains he'd had in his body just were no longer there. That slight catch in his left knee he sometimes felt ever since his football injury in high school wasn't there. The stiffness he felt in his shoulder from throwing too many baseballs from center field in high school and then aggravating it at the company softball tournament, well, it simply wasn't there. The 1/6 gravity made him feel good. It was definitely a business aspect of that feeling he would have to relay further to Gary. Assuming a person could survive the launch and flight, a stay on the moon might make them feel years younger. The longer-term health benefits or detriments would most certainly have to be investigated. It took only a few minutes to cross the dusty lunar plain that stretched between the landing zone and the entrance of the out-of-this-world's airlock, but it was an exciting and surreal few minutes. Paul had to stop and scoop up a handful of the lunar dust and drop it just to get a feel of how different the gravity really was. As soon as he'd done that, he wondered if he should have. The fine grains of the lunar regolith stuck to his suit like styrofoam peanuts do any time they are used as packing materials. The electrostatic interactions between the dust and his suit were more than evident.
"Until you feel it, you just can't truly understand it," he muttered to himself as the dust glittered and danced in the sunlight in front of him.
The arch of the dust descended to the surface, slowly throwing scattered shards of multicolored rays from the sun in every direction. Paul stepped up in front of the airlock door of the lunar hotel and pressed a passcode into the keypad. The door cycled, opened silently, and he stepped in. As the airlock repressurized, Gessling was aware of the strong airflow being directed across his spacesuit and sucked through the grate and into the floor beneath where he was standing. He could see that the air was doing its job of removing much of the pesky lunar dust that had attached itself to his suit during his walk. A considerable amount of the dust remained on the suit, looking like gray smudge prints, mostly on his pants and some around his gauntlets where he had picked up a handful of the moon's surface. Childers knew the lunar dust was going to be a problem and installed the best cleaning system his engineers could provide to try and keep it at a minimum, and Gessling was now providing the system its first real test. Since paying customers wouldn't want to spend a week in a dirty hotel, Childers had spared no expense.
"We'll have to think a bit more seriously about the air shower to clean off a little more of this dust. There is no way that tourists are going to come here without reaching down and playing with the moon dirt," he said to nobody in particular, but he knew that his every word was being recorded for analysis.
In essence, he was leaving himself a note. Satisfied that he was now as clean as the air shower was going to get him, and that the air in the lock was safe to breathe, Gessling removed his helmet to take a deep breath before opening the inner door and into the hotel proper. While he was still a bit dirty, he wasn't too dirty. The air was a bit stale, but otherwise good. Gessling took another deep breath and then keyed in the sequence that would allow him to enter the inflated habitat. The door opened, and he stepped through. The interior was more spacious than Paul remembered. He'd walked through the full-size mock-up many times at Space Excursions Nevada assembly plant, but it never seemed this spacious. And then he realized that it probably seemed big because he and Bill Stetson had spent the last 3 days cooped up in the dreamscape together, and that this was the most open area he'd had since before they launched. Paul laughed to himself at the thought of dreamscape being crowded. He had studied in detail the Apollo mission and the previous mission that the Chinese and Stetson had flown on. The dreamscape was a luxury liner compared to its predecessors. He told himself he was spoiled and to quit whining. The Dreamscape was a reusable hypersonic spaceship made by Space Excursions that was able to take off and land like an airplane and, once refueled in space, make the 6-day round-trip voyage to the moon and back. It could make the trip to loop around the moon and return to Earth without stopping there and not need any modification or additional hardware. To stop at the moon required additional fuel, and the Dreamscape did this by carrying with it an expendable stage that was attached to its frame in Earth orbit before departure. The stage carried enough fuel to slow them down so they could capture into lunar orbit and then start again to boost them back home. Once they were on the way home, the stage would separate and fly into a million-year-long solar orbit before it was likely to crash into anything else in space. But it wasn't just space trash at that point. Gary Childers was too much of an opportunist and businessman to let such a spacecraft go to waste. There were two payload packages aboard the booster stage. One of them housed small canisters, which were actually cremation units holding the remains of several multi-billionaires. The other was a small camera and transceiver package that allowed family members back on Earth to check in on the status of their departed loved ones as they traveled through space. The system was solar-powered and was designed to last for at least 150 years. It was possible it would last even longer. For generations, family members could sit with their long-gone loved ones as they journeyed through deep space. Paul took in a slow breath and made a full 360-degree turn. He looked at the hotel space around him. Gessling made a mental note to share his perceptions with Carolyn and Gary Childers upon his return. After all, if the out-of-this-world seemed big to him, then it was bound to seem big for its future guests as well. The first thing he did was move to the hotel's command computer to personally check out its status. Paul pulled the gauntlets and twisted them. The stiff gloves popped loose and he slid them off his hands. They were cold to the touch. He tethered them to his waist and then tapped at the controls on the computer touchscreen. The screen lit up with a bright blue dot that then expanded and filled the screen. There was a welcome icon and a login tab. Paul tapped the login and entered his username and password. The system screen opened up and displayed a welcome message to him.
"Welcome, Mr. Gessling. Would you like to check in?"
a female computer voice said. Paul laughed and then began inserting information that would allow him to check internal system status, as well as cycle on the entire hotel. He was relieved to see that everything was working as it should. Then, he had to do the basic administrative tasks because it was a hotel. He had to check in before he could stay there. At least he didn't have to leave a credit card number for incidentals. Gary Childers would be picking up the tab for his stay.
"Paul, how does it look?"
The disembodied voice of his boss, Gary Childers, came over the hotel's PA system and startled Gessling, as he was totally engaged in the checkout process. He was glad he was wearing a diaper in his spacesuit.
"Mr. Childers, you startled me,"
Gessling stammered before recovering.
"Sorry, Paul. We're on pins and needles here," Childers replied. "How does it look?"
"It all looks pretty good to me," Gessling said as he surveyed the two-room hotel and habitat.
He was standing in the all-purpose room that contained the onboard control center, the galley, the entertainment center, and the bathroom. Ahead and separated from the main room by only a curtain that was currently not drawn was the storage area and where the guests would sleep. Gessling wasn't yet sure how they would fare sleeping in hammocks they'd have to string up and take down every day. At 1/6 gravity, sleeping on the netting of a hammock shouldn't be uncomfortable, but it didn't quite fit the image of a multi-million dollar getaway to the moon. He would soon find out. He was to bunk here for the night, checking out all of the hotel's features, including the shower, which he thought should feel pretty good right about now, and report back any glitches that needed fixing before the first guest arrived in about a year. Chapter 2. Gary Childers was an old-school businessman running a multi-billion dollar energy company from his corporate headquarters in downtown Lexington, Kentucky, where he'd made his fortune mining, processing, and selling coal. Then came the whole global warming thing, and he'd diversified into solar, geothermal, and offshore wind energy, making more millions in the process. Childers was one of those people who knew how to make money turn into more money, and he did it well and often. At age 65, Childers was also a frustrated space fanatic. As a boy, he'd seen the end of Apollo and the lunar landings that went with it. He lived through Skylab, the International Space Station, and the slow rebirth of American-piloted spaceflight after the retirement of the space shuttle. And the pace at which his beloved NASA was making progress pained him. It pained him so much that he had spent over half his fortune to build a commercial space company that would do more than the other similar startups that were ferrying wealthy businessmen on suborbital joyrides. He built a completely reusable spaceship capable of traveling from Earth to the moon and back again. He built it with passenger seats and big windows. And the millionaires and politicians lined up to take their own five-day joyrides around the moon and back. For the first few years, his space excursions company was a money loser. Then, it broke even. Now it was turning a profit that stockholders would love, had there been any. But Gary Childers didn't want to be beholden to anyone, let alone a bunch of short-sighted investors that didn't know or understand the long view. That's why space excursions remained 100% private and 100% owned by Gary Childers. It was the crew and paying passengers aboard Childers' company's spaceship, the Dreamscape, that had heard the call for help coming from stranded Chinese astronauts in their disastrous attempt to beat America back to the moon just 5 years prior. His friend and chief pilot, Paul Gessling, had then once again come to the rescue by flying the Dreamscape into Earth orbit to bring home the Chinese crew rescued by NASA and stranded there by the actions of a rogue Chinese astronaut among the crew who had apparently thought it would be better to be dead than rescued by Americans. Now he was about to make history again, hopefully in an equally dramatic but less dangerous manner. And it was this topic that he and his public relations manager, Carolyn O'Connor Gessling, were discussing in his last-minute pre-press conference cramming session.
"Carolyn, is the link with Paul up and running?"
Childers asked, waving off Carolyn's attempts to straighten his tie and make the lapel microphone a little less noticeable to the many cameras that awaited him on the other side of the door they were making their way toward.
"Yes, Paul's made himself presentable, tough as that is sometimes, and I think excitement of being on the moon will more than make up for his lack of sleep."
"It's tough duty to have to sleep in a hammock on the moon," said Childers dryly, with sarcasm so thick that it would drip,
had that been physically possible.
He'll be fine, you know, Paul. Now, here's the latest on who will be in the audience for the press conference. You've got another 6 minutes before showtime. Can I get you anything?
Carolyn handed Childers a printed copy listing the press, media, and new media outlets participating in today's press conference. The list contained the usual national and international news networks, the space bloggers, and a few freelance journalists who covered events such as this for whoever hired them to do so.
And the models? Asked Childers.
The models are on the table to the right of the podium and within reach.
Carolyn, don't let Paul take you for granted or he'll have to answer to me. You've got to be the best organizer I've ever had work for me. You haven't missed a beat since I hired you.
Thank you, sir. I'll be sure to tell him after you let him come home from the moon. For now, let's just settle for getting you through this press conference, and then we'll worry about getting my husband back to me.
Right.
Childers smiled and opened the door to the auditorium on the other side. He walked into the familiar surroundings of the company auditorium and the throngs of faces looking back at him. The antiquated sounding click of high-resolution camera shutters was the dominant sound as Childers walked from the door to the podium in front of the assembled media. Just as Carolyn said, to the right of the podium were his toys, models of the dreamscape, the Dasher and the Dancer, Childers' names for the lunar orbiter and lander, respectively, and the Out of This World, the lunar hotel in which Paul Gessling had spent his lunar sleep cycle. The sight of his toys evoked a smile, which in turn calmed his nerves and put him into his element, explaining the latest company milestones to a group of interested and anxious reporters.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your attention. Today I am pleased to announce that Space Excursions has accomplished yet another space first and is preparing the way for a series of further successful firsts. Last night, Space Excursions employee and chief pilot Paul Gessling spent the night on the moon, resting as the first guest in the company's lunar hotel, while former NASA astronaut Bill Stetson, who accompanied him on the lunar voyage, remained in the orbiting Dasher module. Gessling will remain on the moon for another day and night, and then he will return to lunar orbit to rejoin Mr. Stetson and make the homeward trip to Earth. You'll hear from Mr. Gessling live from the surface of the moon in just a few moments.
Childers paused to assess his audience. He was a gifted spokesman and, as with many similarly talented speakers, he knew that the key to making a good speech is to make sure that you understood your audience and that they understood you. Judging by his quick scan of the faces in the room, he was sure he was in a good place.
Following the successful return of Messrs. Gessling and Stetson, and in about 18 months, Space Excursions will relaunch the Dasher and Dancer spacecraft with their first party of tourists bound for the lunar surface and a week-long stay at the Out of This World, where they will experience firsthand both deep space flight and the thrill of actually walking on the surface of an alien world, in this case, our moon. Before we transfer to the moon and Mr. Gessling, are there any questions for me?
Hands all across the room went up. Childers, not being a politician and therefore not really giving a damn if he ticked off a reporter or two, had his favorites among the crowd, and he called upon one of them first. In this case, Doreen Davidson, not only because he liked the alliteration of her name, but also because he liked her blog, and that she had always written positively about space excursions in the past.
Mr. Childers, we know there will be 6 paying customers on the next flight and staying on the moon in your hotel. Can you tell us who they are?
She asked.
As I think we clearly explained in our press release, we're not going to provide those names at this time. If one of the passengers wants to make themselves known, that is up to them. But we all signed some fairly strict confidentiality papers that my lawyers advised me to stick with. I suspect you'll know who they are by the time we actually launch, but again, that's strictly up to them.
Next, he called on the reporter from the BBC.
Mr. Childers, you and your company are among a group of companies spending obscene amounts of money in space to dubious benefit. With at least 5 companies now working to mine asteroids for private gain, a recent poll in Europe showed that a majority don't approve of the world's rich elite taking extravagant trips to the moon, while so many on the planet are living in poverty and barely able to subsist. There's even been a discussion of banning European citizens from flying on your ship. How can you justify this overt display of excess?
The BBC reporter, a man in his mid-20s with a clear upper-crust British accent, looked at Childers with a smug smile and the arrogance that only a well-heeled Brit could possibly manage.
Mr. Bryhall, the last time I checked, the United States of America is neither subject to European opinion polls nor its politicians. Furthermore, as a believer in economic freedom and the right of people to spend their money as they choose, I am inclined to tell the good people sampling in your poll where they can put their sanctimonious better-than-thou attitudes. But I won't, since I am a gentleman and since I don't want to cause an international incident. And, most importantly, because I want to sell rides to the moon to my many European friends.
Challengers looked and was annoyed. He continued,
Let's just say that in aggregate, the world is a much better and more affluent place to live today than at any time in history. Personally, I attribute that as the inevitable outcome of free people in free economies spending their hard-earned money as they so choose. Space technology is helping to lift the economies of the world in ways that were unimaginable just a few years ago, and I won't even try to list them all. Instead, I recommend you do some reading. There are several great books out there that describe what I'm talking about. If you and your colleagues don't want to participate, then don't. And please keep your hands out of my pockets while you pursue whatever it is you decide to pursue.
With that, Childers was through talking to the BBC reporter and on to the next.
Mr. Childers, are you going to fly on one of your own rockets? And if so, when?
The question came from a female freelance journalist that often wrote space-friendly articles for space.com and other sites frequented by space advocates.
Well,
he paused and thought briefly at the question. Then Childers smiled and raised his left eyebrow just before he answered.
That's two questions. To answer the first, yes, I plan to go. The answer to the second question, I will leave to your speculation.
After about 10 more minutes of mostly benign questions, Childers walked toward a large hyper-resolution monitor that was displaying the Space Excursions corporate logo. He nodded to Carolyn, and the image of Paul Gessling appeared on the screen. Gessling was in short sleeves and standing in front of one of the large viewing windows of the Out of This World, showing the truly spectacular lunar landscape immediately behind and outside. The 3D image was stunning, giving those in the room the sense that they too were on the moon.
For your next round of questions, you'll be speaking with Paul Gessling from the surface of the moon,
said Childers, looking for all the world like a 65-year-old kid on Christmas morning.
Good afternoon, and welcome to the Out of This World,
Gessling said as he did his best not to smile like a kid in a toy store. He gestured somewhat excitedly as he began to walk through the interior of the habitat. The camera tracked his movement across the floor and faded into a different view as he approached a closer camera on the side wall. The automated camera system was working flawlessly.
This is where I spent the night and where our guests will spend their week on the moon. Now, let me show you around.
The tour continued as Gessling moved around the habitat, stopping at each point of interest, including the toilet.
Mr. Childers, it's time for you to leave for Nevada. Paul and Hammy can take it from here,
whispered Carolyn, trying not to be heard through the microphone as she spoke.
Ladies and gentlemen, I need to get on the road. My associate, Hammy Kunda, will answer any additional questions you may have.
Childers moved toward the exit where Carolyn and the rest of his entourage that would accompany him to the airport and on the Space Excursions private jet to Nevada. It was a beautiful Kentucky day, and Childers stopped on the way to his limousine to admire the brilliant blue sky filled with jet contrails that contrasted with the ever-growing Lexington skyline. The sight conjured in his mind's eye the thought that had driven him since he was a boy.
One of these days, instead of jet contrails, those will be rocket exhausts and will be flying people to and from space by the hundreds each and every day.
The thought lingered in his mind as he started to move toward the limo, and just as suddenly as the thought of rockets had popped into his mind, the first 7.62 by 63 millimeter slug caught him in his right leg, shattering bone as it tore through his skin. Skin, bone, ligament, and muscle tissue flew from his leg in a spray of pink, red, and flesh-colored mist. Childers was pushed backward and spun clockwise by the impact as the mist and tissue fragments splattered against the open limo door. He twisted sideways from the impact, knocking Carolyn off balance and directly into the path of the next bullet as he fell to the ground. The second slug caught Carolyn in her upper back, which was now facing in the direction she'd been walking just seconds before. The bullet passed through her like a warm knife through butter, perforating her left lung and making a large and bloody exit wound. She, too, fell to the ground. The wound gushed in red and made a wheezing and sucking sound each time her heart beat or she struggled for a breath. Max Potter, Childers' longtime bodyguard, was on Childers as soon as he realized what was happening. Moving as he had been trained, he only momentarily had the wherewithal to consider aiding the stricken O'Connor instead of his boss. Realizing that she had not likely been the primary target of the attack and likely not to be shot again, he moved toward Childers. Potter, outweighing the aging Childers by 2-1, formed the perfect human shield for his boss as the next two slugs meant for Childers struck him. Even though the bodyguard was wearing a level 4 bulletproof vest under his sport coat, the very large and fast sniper rounds tore through him like the armor wasn't even there, killing him instantly. There were now three bodies on the ground, one dead and two who would be soon if nothing was done. Childers' other assistants scattered, as did the pedestrians who just happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time and in the line of fire. It was one of the pedestrians who called 911 from the safety of a doorway just behind where the bodies were bleeding out on the ground. Just as instantly as the thoughts of rocket contrails had popped into Childers' mind, and just as instantly as the sniper rounds had made life-altering and life-taking impact on them, the shooting stopped. Chapter 3. Paul Gessling and Bill Stetson should have been leaving lunar orbit for home with a sense of triumph. Both had visited the moon more than once. Gessling had now piloted 5 of Space Excursions' commercial trips around the moon and back to the Earth in the reusable Dreamscape spacecraft. Lunar tourism was Space Excursions' first commercial space venture. It was a resounding success and formed the financial basis that now enabled the company to build a lunar hotel. Stetson had walked on the moon during the rescue of the stranded Chinese astronauts. Now he was coming home with a fellow moonwalker. They were not feeling triumphant. Instead, they felt powerless and, worse still, useless, especially Gessling. His colleague and friend was nearly a quarter of a million miles from home and from his wife, and there was absolutely nothing either of them could do to help her or to get home any faster. Orbital mechanics just would not allow it. "I can't believe anyone would want to kill Gary Childers," said Bill as he watched the ship's instruments, pausing only briefly to peer out the window at the rapidly receding moon. "I can't believe that Carolyn's been shot. Damn it all to hell. I feel so helpless way out here. When they catch whoever did this, I'll kill him. I swear I'll kill him." Stetson knew his buddy was worried sick and blowing off steam, so he didn't bother reminding his friend that he couldn't hurt a fly and that he was a huge believer in the rule of law. It wouldn't serve any purpose to try and talk reason with someone in an unreasonable state, unreasonable distances from home, following such unreasonable and horrific acts. "Who would do such a thing anyway?" Gessling shook his head in disbelief. "People are screwed up, Paul. Gary is a successful businessman at a time that people don't value the rugged individual like they used to. It doesn't help that he's so damned outspoken about what he believes," Bill said, hoping to reassure his friend. "They'll be okay. She'll be okay." Stetson knew that Gessling and Childers were friends as well as colleagues. He was getting to know Childers, but he wasn't likely to ever get into the man's inner circle where Gessling resided. Only going together through the hard knocks of growing a business, being in the trenches together, could grow the camaraderie that these two men shared. Stetson knew that he had to try and get his friend to think of something other than his critically injured wife, if that were even possible. Looking out the port at the black sky and the eternal gray sphere that was the moon, he tried feverishly to come up with something to say that would change the subject, even if it were only for a few brief minutes.
"Well, would you just look at that?"
Finally, Stetson broke the silence.
"Look at the Earth. Isn't it beautiful? I never get tired of looking at it. And from here, you can see the whole sphere.
No political boundaries visible from up here.
It's hard to believe there are now over 7 billion people. When I was a boy, there were fewer than 4 billion, and we wondered then how we were going to feed them all."
Stetson pursed his lips and continued.
"But we managed. And now there are that many people in the middle class alone. Yep, it's a better time to be on Earth now than at any time in human history."
"But for how long? 4 billion people consuming resources at the same rate as 300 million Americans doesn't seem sustainable. And it isn't. Look at Africa. The South African war has been raging for nearly 3 years with no end in sight. Both sides are just proxies for the Chinese and the West, each backing their favorite dictators and warlords just because they want the mineral rights if their side is victorious."
Gessling's mood was certainly sour. But Bill understood. If somebody had told him that a maniac shot his wife, he'd be in an equal or worse fugue.
"Paul, I know you are worried, but I've never heard you be this pessimistic. I just can't believe you buy that limits to growth crap. Look where you are. You're in space, where the resources are unlimited. There are more minerals on the moon and in near-Earth asteroids than there are accessible on Earth. That's why those space mining companies are coming to Mr. Childers to build them their habitats. They have to have a place for their miners to live when they're out here getting the mineral resources ready to be sent back to Earth. Pretty soon, those African warlords will look around and see that no one is backing them anymore because it's easier and more ethical to get the same resources from up here.
Bill, do you honestly believe we can mine the asteroids on a scale that will make any difference? Right now, that seems like it's millions of years away. Science fiction. It can't be cost-effective with today's technology.
Yes. Yes, I do. Stetson didn't blink. And I also know that when Japan finishes their prototype space solar power station and starts beaming clean, zero greenhouse gas emission power back to their resource-starved island, that other countries will take notice and start building their own power stations. I'm angry that the first one will be Japanese and not American. But hey, as long as someone is building it, that's just fine by me.
Space solar power. I still don't buy it being cost-effective. Or safe, for that matter. But who the hell knows? Cost-effective or not, Carolyn would have loved to write the press release for something like that,
Gessling said with an even darker tone. Stop talking like that, barked Stetson, incensed that his friend was talking of his wife in the past tense. She'll write press releases for things more exciting than that, like the first trip to Mars in a few years. She's alive and in the care of some of the best trauma surgeons in the country. They'll pull her through, and Mr. Childers to boot. As if on cue, the radio beeped to alert them that someone from back home in Nevada wanted to have a conversation. Thus far, all of their musings had been made with the radio muted, and all recording devices on the ship purposely turned off. Bill had insisted on it. Gessling remained fixated on the view through the port while Stetson reacted to the signal and turned on the ship's radio. Stetson knew that his friend wouldn't be up for talking unless there was news about his wife.
Stetson here. What's up?
Bill, we have some news. Gary Childers is out of surgery, and it looks like he'll make it. One of the bullets shattered a bone in his leg, and the other passed clean through his body without hitting a vital organ. He suffered a great deal of blood loss, but not enough to do any permanent damage. Fortunately, whoever the sniper was wasn't a very good shot.
That's great news, but what about Carolyn? What do you know about her situation?
Carolyn is still in surgery, and we don't know anything other than that she's alive and in the operating room. No word yet on the shooter either. The news reports say that whoever did it covered their tracks really well. We'll call back when we know something.
Sounds good. Out.
With that, Stetson again turned off the radio, not wanting the ground crew or anyone else to hear the private conversation between him and Paul. That just wouldn't be right.
Chapter 4. Using the gift given to humanity by the 20th century Prometheus, who inhabited the Oak Ridge and Los Alamos National Laboratories in the 1940s, the liquid hydrogen propellant flowed through the core of the nuclear thermal rocket engine, heating it to over 1200 degrees Celsius and giving the unmanned stage a kick as it then accelerated out of Earth orbit and into interplanetary space. There was no smoke, not just because there was no air, but because the heated hydrogen wasn't combusting at all. It had merely been superheated in order to create an overpressure inside the rocket engine's combustion chamber, which wasn't really a combustion chamber at all. And then the overpressured hydrogen gas was accelerated due to the laws of fluid flow and thermodynamics down a converging nozzle to a small opening that rocket scientists called the throat, where it reached supersonic flow speeds. From there, the gas continued to accelerate out a diverging nozzle into space. At no point was a detonation, deflagration, or combustion exothermic reaction required. The nuclear core was simply there to heat up a liquid and turn it into hot gas, just as it would if it were in a power plant back on Earth. But instead of using the hot gas to turn a turbine and generate electricity, this reactor was heating propellant to provide propulsion at twice the efficiency of any conventional chemical rocket, including even the most efficient and effective combustion-based rocket engines ever built before, such as the Space Shuttle main engines and the F-1s of the Saturn V era. No, this rocket wasn't like most of its ancestors. Instead of heating and expelling fuel through burning, it was being heated to much higher temperatures by the energy released from the splitting of uranium atoms in the core of the ship's engines. First conceived and tested by the United States in the 1960s, nuclear thermal rockets required only half the fuel to get the same performance as chemical rockets. This was the breakthrough that was going to allow humans to make the journey to Mars affordably, and the flight was scheduled to begin 2 years hence. Launched into space by NASA's heavy lift rocket, the nuclear stage was designed to operate only once it was in space. The risks of using nuclear energy to launch rockets from the surface of the Earth was simply too great, or perceived to be, for anyone to suggest. The news that the engine had started was greeted by shouts and cheers of joy in Mission Control, still located at the Johnson Space Center in Texas. While it was greeted by cheers, They were mostly preceded by the sound of people breathing after holding their breath too long in the adjunct control center at the Marshall Space Flight Center in Huntsville, Alabama. It was there that the engine was designed, and no group of people could be happier that it worked. They knew all that could go wrong, the things they'd tried to design to mitigate, and sometimes knowledge can cause one to be pessimistic. Pessimism and its cousin Murphy, of Murphy's Law, were not around. The engines performed as designed, and they worked flawlessly.
"Hot damn!"
exclaimed the Marshall Chief Engineer Paula Downey. Downey was a graduate of Stanford and had worked for NASA nearly all of her 25-year career. She'd cut her teeth working on new space propulsion technologies back in the early 2000s, and quickly proved to her peers and to senior management that she knew her engineering and was better than most at getting to the root cause of many engineering problems encountered in rocket science. Downey began walking around the room, shaking hands, slapping backs, and even hugging some of the engineers in the room who'd worked on the nuclear rocket project for these last several years. This was one of the reasons she was not only respected for her engineering talents, but actually liked by her peers. She was a people person, and knew how to relate to the many personality types that made up the workforce of NASA. It didn't hurt that, at age 50, she was still a beautiful woman with a figure that turned heads when she walked through a room. Her black hair was salted with gray, and no one really cared if that was its natural color. She was a pleasure to see, to talk to, and to work with.
"Paula, I guess this means that we're a go for Mars?"
asked Dean Epperson, one of the systems engineers on the team.
"Dean, I guess it does. If the Habitat and the Lander teams can meet their testing milestones like this team did, we'll be launching to Mars in just under 2 years."
"I never thought I'd see the day," he replied. "It seems like every time we think we're going somewhere, the politicians or the bean counters pull the rug out from under us."
"Let's hope that doesn't happen this time," she said with a false and overly emphasized frown. "There's too much at stake. Now that the Europeans, the Japanese, and the Chinese have signed on, I don't think that even the upcoming presidential election will be able to slow us down."
"Don't say that. I was here when the shuttle stopped flying and the program to replace them was temporarily shut down. If you told me then that we'd be testing the systems to go to Mars, I'd think you were nuts. Never forget that we're a political agency, and all it'll take to shut us down is one anti-space person in the White House."
"That's a good point, but this time, I think we'll make the transition. We've got the support of both parties in the Senate. Strong support, I might add. It helps when you have former astronauts in each party handing the chairman."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.